Okay, I'll bring it back to council. Oh, excuse me, hello?
Sorry, a little slow on the draw. Brian Fouch, Monterey Park Neighborhood Watch. First of all, we have a lot of resources in this community. We have people, our people are resources, and we're not just volunteers. Many of us are stewards of our community, and so I want to promote that concept. Yes, volunteers are difficult to deal with, but stewards are not, because we are highly committed to what we do. I want to emphasize something Caleb said. Mr. Randall, I would like to emphasize not just making parents pay, but making the individuals pay. And we know minors don't have a lot of money, but they do have a lot of time on their hands, apparently. So I think a best solution with respect to minors, and I know this ordinance deals, the changes deal extensively with how we're going to treat minors. We don't really deal too much with how we're going to treat adults who are also perpetrating this crime. And there are many who are adults who have been doing this for a long time who still do it past the age of 18. And they're perfectly willing to buy paint for the younger folks who want to get involved. So I think these people need to be treated as harshly as possible. Fines, in addition to community service, I think is in order for those folks. And I'd like to see that a special component of the ordinance. It needs to be, we need to deal with these adults the way that they need to be dealt with. And I think there should be mandatory community service for these people. We have a lot of parks, we have a lot of public spaces, we have a lot of things that we just can't get to. And with a managed group of people who are doing community service, I think all that's possible. And we certainly have a lot of people who are trying to tear us down. Let's put them to work. And I want to look at section 14A, 21. Seems to be a little bit, maybe a little bit off. Just give me a second here to find it. I'm sorry. There is a reference there in that particular section to what minors, oh, here we are, 14A-21 on page 8 of 10 of the cleaned up version. For the purpose of this section, diversion of the offending violator to a community service program or plea bargain to a lesser offense shall constitute a conviction. It seems to be a little out of place there, and I would recommend that you expand that section to incorporate these penalties that I'm talking about. And if it was only eradication that we were doing, I would say that that is a problem, but that's not the case. Clearly, we're all about doing a lot more than that. So I really appreciate Councilmember McShane's leadership on this and all of your involvement. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Is there anyone else? Okay, seeing no one. Bringing it back to council for council member comments. My left.
Mayor, I'd like to move. Oh no, this is to introduce the ordinance. But with the caveat that we do look at some of the issues that were brought up, specifically with the land entitlements. And I think that absolutely we need to look at, it's not just future growth area, but look at other buildings that have become canvases.
Okay, Councilmember McShane, you had your hand up.
Yeah, to Councilwoman Lutz's point, certainly her district and my district, I think together, represent most of the graffiti. She leads consistently with incidents in District 3 square footage. It's a big issue. And as I think Ms. Rosenblum pointed out, this is the number one issue for Old Town Salinas Association business owners in general, and I think people at large. A number of folks that have gone into this, Republic Service has been wonderful. You know, that hotline is a real tool. So it's something that's kind of front and center. The various neighborhood groups is Rex McIntosh, Los Livos Riker, Monterey Park Neighborhood Watch, the Chamber, even Naval Postgraduate School was at some of our meetings. And the good news is we've really consolidated, and I think we're on our way to a model for how a city that's strapped for cash can go about addressing graffiti. The quarterly meetings, the next of which is the 24th of October, right in this room. We'd invite people to attend. To a couple of the points made, and as Chris goes back to kind of fine-tune before we pass this next meeting, I think that referencing the walls, in addition to some of the other things, is worth it. Anytime we go from you know, consider to shall is important. So just be sure that, you know, we're not getting too excited. But I think it is important to address that, certainly as it deals with landscaping. And as Councilman Sanchez referenced with enforcement, the task force is very involved there. Members of the task force have initiated their own stings and have plenty of lively stories that come out every time we meet quarterly as a task force. But to the city's tools that are easy and within reach, as private citizens have been encouraged to report graffiti, even with a text message, it's unbelievable how quick Republic has responded. It's also important for citizens to report places of business that sell the materials that are in violation. And we've been doing that, and very quickly, Vanessa Shop, Chris, fires off a letter, and we've seen great response to hardware stores and folks that sell the material, posting the proper signage and locking things up. So don't need to go on very much longer. I think that this is just a real landmark example of how city and private and business organizations and stewards can work together to address something that's pretty significant per capita for a city our size. So that's probably all I could say.
Come right.
I have a comment.
Oh, I'm sorry, Council.
And it's hard to see us on this side. You know what? I just gotta share with you that there's a whole issue of who sells the materials, and the parents are supposed to know what happens with their kids, and that's the real big disconnect. The businesses, one good example is they'll sell things. They have gang slogans. They'll make shirts and pants and hats, and they'll sell them, and they'll sell them cheap for the kids, and they do it because it's business. And because of the dollar, and they'll sell guns, fake guns, with, you know, they look almost real, and they'll do it just to sell. Liquor stores are selling them. You have the indoor swap meets are selling all this stuff, and they do it, and it's just for business. So there's no accountability for doing that. And when it comes to these materials, a lot of the stores, especially the dollar stores, and a couple of the top hardware stores in town, they allow, they kind of encourage the sales of this stuff to kids, and there's nothing being done about that. So there's a whole accountability of parents and businesses. We're going to do this, deals with the kids and the consequences to them, but I think we need to really work on enforcing it to the stores and really sending them notice. This is what you go face if you do this. And actually partner up with STEPS. Maybe this is another challenge for them, because they work with us on tobacco and alcohol. So let's get them to do some things and go out there after we do some notifying, some informing, some educating, and then doing some enforcement and holding people accountable. Because without those pen, I'm telling you, those kids are not going to get a hold of them unless they get them in their local stores and they get them in their neighborhoods. They just don't have a car to be running around and picking up the stuff, but somebody gets them to them. So we need to hold stores accountable. And because of the money, they say, well, I got to sell them. If I can sell 100 pence a month, and you know, that's money for me. And so we got to hold people accountable. The parents, that's what they're going to come up with the excuse, well, I don't know my kid and he doesn't listen to me. I have no money. No, well, we need to hold the parent accountable. I give you the story of my mom. I mean, my mom had an old car that she really wanted. She's had it since 1979, but it had no tags, and it was in the back of the car. The fire department said, you can't have it there, lady. She says, okay. So they gave her a ticket. She didn't move it. Well, she moved it now. She got rid of it. She finally went to the junkyard, but she couldn't pay it. She's in a fixed income, so they made her to do community service hours. The lady's 60 years old. She's a healthy 60-year-old. But, you know, she did her good job, and did she have another car there? Hell no, she'll never have another car parked at her house. But she was held accountable, and the excuse, I don't have money, I'm a senior, I don't have resources, that was not, the judge said, you're going to do some community service. So I think we really got to put an emphasis on holding adults accountable and holding the businesses accountable. The kid, there's stuff in here, including the California code, that already says that a kid's license could be suspended under age 18 for up to 2 years. And just so you know, Assemblymember Alejo brought together a coalition of people from all over the region to talk about a bill that actually makes it stronger so the judges can use it. So that's coming up next year, and so we should pay attention to what that does, because and Salinas should definitely give its input, because that's another way to deter it. It's a you tag it, you lose it. You're gonna lose your license. And a lot of kids, that's what they're waiting for, to get their license. If you say you're 15, you go tag something, you're not gonna have a license until you're 18. And that's gonna be an incentive for them not to do it. So we definitely, I think we go farther if we educate and promote it versus trying to have more cops to chase kids with pens and all that stuff. It's just gonna be impossible. But I think educating, working with the schools, and I think STEPS is, might be a good relationship to work with, because they've been able to help us with the alcohol and the tobacco. Anyway, good improvement, but I think the enforcement piece of it is gonna be the challenge.
Mm-hmm. To my right, Councilmember Barrera, anything?
Well, I think that this is a good way of bringing the entire council together. This is a city problem, not just certain districts. So I remember when we were having an issue in District 4, we had a neighborhood meeting, and the gentleman that put the meeting together had asked for certain ideas that he had and who can implement them. So Councilmember McShane and Mayor Pro Tem De La Rosa and myself, we came together, and you did a good job. And I think as we go together, as we develop these stewards, because I think it's critical, different parts of town, blaming other parts of town, that's not going to solve anything. My biggest concern is this enforcement. We can put a lot of things in our books, but we have to work smart. I like the way the gentleman said, you know what, let's put something out there that's it's eye-catching and get that fly. Mm-hmm. Pretty smart. And that's so, because I agree, you know what, at the end of the year, we're going to see what did we accomplish. Hey, we went and painted X amount of fences and we did this, but it cost us $100,000. And here we go the next year and we do the same thing. So I think we have to work smarter, and I think there's several people here, whether it's business, community, let's come together. Because I think with Councilmember McShane's leadership, we're gonna be doing some things. And with individuals like Mr. McIntosh, when people take an interest in their neighborhoods, I think that's when positive change is gonna happen. So thank you.
Okay, thank you for your comments. And you're absolutely right. Okay. And you're absolutely right. Coming together as a community, we have a lot of resources out there. And, and you know, the churches are another organization that they've been doing a lot of, you know, also the removing graffiti. But just coming together as a community, we can make it happen. And I really want to thank the task force and Mr. Kenyon and just all the great work that, and all the time that you put into to bringing this ordinance forward. and I agree with my colleagues that if you tag, then you need to remove it. Just like at home, you did something, guess what? You're gonna go and take it off. And also giving options to the parents, because some cities do fine the parents, but they also, if the kid doesn't remove it, the parent does. So you know, we have so many options, but again, it's just sending that message that we're not gonna have taggers here. You're gonna be responsible, or the parent, and to make our city beautiful. Because I'll tell you, tagging is everywhere. It's universal. I was in New York in the subway, and you're going, and there's all this tagging, you know, all over the walls. So again, but we want our city to be beautiful and clean, and we're gonna make it happen, but as a community. So the ordinance was introduced by Councilmember Lutz, and Vanessa would like to make a comment.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem. I just wanted to briefly clarify, and we will bring it back with the additional review that the council's requested to you in 2 weeks. I did just want to clarify that the ordinance actually does contain many of the things several of the public commentators requested. It really expands the options for, it's not saying just go after the parents or just, It's really just giving the council a number of additional tools that we didn't have before. It is focused. Previously, our ordinance made no reference to minors. Now it incorporates an element that allows us to look at that. This is just is giving it. It's you're widening your toolbox with the ordinance that's been introduced. And if you look at the page 9 of 10 of the ordinance that outlines the penalties, you have the option of prosecuting criminally, you have the option of prosecuting through the administrative remedies process, you have the option of looking to the parents, you can participate in the legal process where the judge is sentencing a minor and say this should be a community service item, not a fine. Or there's a lot of inputs that that the city could have resources permitting. Thank you.
Okay. Now we'll move on to our public hearing, and it's the false alarm fee increase and contract for billing services, and that's Mr. Matt Pressy.
Thank you, Honorable Mayor Pro Tem and members of City Council. Before you are two items that will also be heard on September 27th. This is just the first public hearing of two, and both items will be brought back. The first item is a service contract for billing and tracking services with Public Safety Corporation, and the second is an increase in our false alarm fee rate from $114 to $137. Currently, the city, over the past 6 years, has reached a high point in their false alarm billing, the number of incidents at about 3,300, and that represents about 3,550 false alarms, where 98.5% are false alarms of those alarms that go off. As you can see by the history and the little chart before you, the revenue, the fees go back down to about $100 in the 05-06 year, and I've shown the last six there. And that's when the last calculation and fee study was done. So we've re-upped the fee study, and these increases in the history you see there are really consumer price index changes, and those were adopted as part of the annual user fee update. So this year we've, as part of reevaluating all our fees, and there will be a fee study done for all our fees, but this one we wanted to take separate and move forward a little ahead of schedule of the other fees. And so we did a fee study, and that new fee study is going to be about $137, and that basically represents the current cost and recapture methodology to recapture that cost of sending out two officers on a false alarm incident. This table before you kind of reflects our typical cities that we do when we do our annual fee study. We council in the past has that requested comparability, and the purpose is to kind of get a benchmark on what else is going on. In this particular chart, you'll see the first column of numbers. There's four cities in our typical set of 14 city comparable cities where there's a flat fee, and then Salinas is a fifth one in that group. We're third from the bottom or second from the top in as far as comparability. And I guess at this point I'll remind City Council that these fees that they're charging are meant to recapture the cost, and the cost is we cannot recapture more than the cost it takes to incur the service. So each city would have done a study, and you can see some are fixed costs, but then some are also on a sliding scale. And at first, staff looked at this, and we were looking at wanting to do a sliding scale where we would have $100 for the first incident call out of the false alarm, the second 200, and the third 300, similar to what the County of Monterey is doing, and they start at 50 and go all the way up to 400. But we didn't have sufficient data to be able to distinguish and to come up with a study that is representative of the cost, and so we chose to go with a flat fee at this point. But after a year of service, we can come back to council if council is interested in a sliding scale, and we can discuss that a little more at the end. So moving on, the next slide reflects the new agreement, and that's with Public Safety Corporation. They're actually a leader in the industry. They focus only on public safety, false alarm billing and tracking, and they have a proprietary software that they use. They actually even sell that software out to cities, and they serve all throughout the nation, and they are truly a leader. So staff had made contact with them. We also did a local informal bidding with a local vendor that also does billing, and then we also looked at other requests for proposals that they've participated in, and actually took advantage of those requests for proposal process and took, in this case, Public Safety Corporation, the lowest bidder, and then further negotiated the rate to come up with something that's a win-win. And for us, their fee and the fee structures presented up there would result in the city actually having a savings of not only recapturing the cost of their fee, but being able to generate additional revenue that we're currently not able to do given our current process and system that we should be collecting, and then also the staff that we currently use for the billing process would be able to be diverted toward other things. And so all of that bundled together, we still come out ahead. So that's very positive. And one other thing regarding Public Safety Corporation, their services are top quality. They have excellent customer service and a good reputation. We've checked with them, and one of the implementers said they not only did excellent in selling their services, and usually that's where it ends, they were even better in implementing and making it happen. So that was a significant testimony. And they have bilingual staff to address it. They have secure online payment options and really cutting edge technology that will allow our residents, our business community, to take care of their business, and also city staff to report on the progress. So we're hoping that once they come on board, there will be good data that's generated, and we can use that as to even further refine how we manage this process. But in the meantime, this is a good start. The fee is based off a sliding, or not a sliding scale, but a tiered approach. So the first $75,000 of revenue, we've negotiated 35%. The next 75, from 75 to 150, is 25%. The next 100,000 from 150 to 250 is at 18%, and anything over 250 is at 15%. And so we're projecting 342,000 to be generated by their billing activity, and this chart reflects their fee at about 22% of that. And the original proposal that they had presented, and before negotiation, it was in the 34% range. So and a lot of other cities that we've saw have that higher rate. So this is a significant price point for the city. So The next slide gets into a little more detail that is beyond what you have in the staff report, more for reference purposes if we want to get into what is the makeup of how we estimated the revenue. This gives the breakdown of false alarms, new permits, renewals, and I can describe that in more detail if you have questions. And I guess the price point, going back to the 137, that really, in comparing the old fee of 114 and all the components and the new fee of 137, it all really comes down to personnel costs, and those did go up, and that's the reason for the increase. So with that, we're recommending that the council move forward with approving the contract and the rate, but again, this is a two-step process, so both of these actions and recommendations will be heard again on the 27th. Since this is a fee increase, there needs to be two public hearings. With that, I'd like to make myself available for questions. Thank you.
Councilmember.
Hi there. Couple of things. First and foremost, for the recommendations, I wholeheartedly support contracting it out to the Public Service Corporation. I think that that's a great idea and a great way for us to be able to follow up on outstanding invoices that we have not been able to collect on. So I think they have a great reputation. I think you said, is it county or city of Monterey uses them as well?
County.
Okay. So I think that that is definitely a good recommendation. Secondly, I'm kind of questioning a little bit the significant increase. I know that you've talked about personnel costs. I also am here to be a watchdog for the rest of the areas in the community and see what those costs are comparatively to our city. I certainly realize that we are five times the size of our nearest neighbor of the city of Monterey, but I can't help but notice the fees that that the other cities are incurring are much more tolerable, I guess is a good word. Sure. And I'm curious, and here's my first question. In terms of percentages, when we're talking about the false alarms that go off, are we talking about 98% of those false alarms are first-time offenders, and so we have a flat fee of $137? And I know for me, I've got an alarm on my home, and I've had Salinas PD called out to my house, and I got the $112 fee. But if I am a business in the area, or I'm a resident with a faulty alarm, and I'm on my 20th false alarm, and they get $137. I mean, what is the percentage of those calls are, I guess, habitual offenders?
Sure. I was able to locate some old data that was a reflective of 1 month, and given the system, we actually found it difficult to be able to consolidate. The data that we bill on is based off of, or is consolidated by business, and so we have one, for example, one place that we bill for certain shops that are have multiple locations. So to get the precise calculation, we weren't able to do that, but we did look at some historic data, and they reflected about 71% of the billings were all first time. And then the rest was kind of distributed between 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, and 5 years, and not that many beyond that.
Is that a service that the Public Safety Corporation can provide to the city?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. That's one of the significant advantages, is they have a robust tracking system where they're getting all that data and building that database. And currently we don't have that database at all.
Gotcha. Okay. And the purpose, and this is actually for the rest of the council, the purpose of my question is because if we have a $350,000 budget, of which 71% of those calls are first-time offenders, and we go to a graduated, fee system, and the first one is no charge, we're essentially eliminating 71% of that budget in our first fine. So I want to be cognizant of the budget that we have put forward, you know, the $350,000 that we're already getting. But I also think, too, if we have our officers going to the same location 20 times, there should be a repercussion for that. I think that we need to look at a graduated fee or fine system, as some of our other cities have done. They go, you know, the first fine is $100, the second fine is $200, the third, fourth, fifth, and therefore, you know, anything thereafter is $500. I think that that's something that we should take a look at, and I know that you're good at crunching numbers, so I'm sure that we can look. I'm not necessarily interested in going backwards in terms of the first fine. I think a graduated system is fine where we are, but I have a difficult time with a 20% increase going from 114 to 137. Mm-hmm. And if I'm, you know, a first-time offender and I've got my false alarms going off and I think that there's a burglar in my house, I don't think that I should be fined the same amount if somebody who has been called 20 times. So that's my 2 cents. Thanks.
Councilmember McShane.
It seems like going with the PSC is going to save some money.
Yes.
So why do we have to raise the rate? Why don't we decrease the rate or even leave it as is, contract with PSC and see? I mean, it looks like if there's some cost savings, we should pass that on to the people that are smart enough and kind enough to our public safety folks to have this additional feature installed in their homes. So I guess my question is there a minimum that we have to be at, or is there a certain threshold for PSC to play ball with us, or is there a way we can restructure it so that we don't have to increase the rate while considering contracting with them? That's the first question. There's two.
Okay. Regarding the first question, as far as the fee, is there a minimum? And as far as the contract is concerned with them, that's something that I think we've reached a negotiating point with them, and we can renegotiate that further. I think the reducing their cost, they have a certain base cost, and they've made that clear, and the structure allows them to recapture that in the earlier dollars, which is fair. And as far as the reducing it I guess council can choose whatever fee it wants, and the fee didn't go up because their costs went up. It's actually close to a wash. The fee mainly went up because of the cost of the hour of the officers, two officers, and the hour of time that's associated with that has gone up. And so that really is the cost driver. When you compare the overhead, the staff time of police clerk staff time, finance staff time, that's comparable to what their fee is. And so we can certainly, you know, let them know that we'd like a better deal. This contract is contingent upon this agreement going forth as is, or the fee structure. And certainly, if this fee structure is, if council wants to change that, then we are back at the table with them. So that is always an option to negotiate that further, but I don't think we'll get enough to reduce it or to the same amount as 114.
Just a quick follow-up.
Could I just add to Mr. Pressey's response, Councilmember McShane, that it's I think what Matt meant to say when he said that council's free to choose any rate it wants. It's not like we can just come up with something out of thin air. There's really strict requirements about how we set these fees, okay? And so those are right, we can't make money. It's set by the California Constitution 13B and by our own city code that outlines what Matt has described for you, we can recover the costs that we have reasonably borne in providing the service. So we're providing a service, it costs us money to deliver that service, and the Constitution and our own city code set out what elements we can recover. So those are the things that have been enumerated. It's all our direct costs, salaries, wages, benefits, overtime, indirect costs, fixed assets, general overhead, departmental overhead. I mean, these are all set out in a lot of the law on this subject. So there are some limitations on how far we can go.
Right.
But what staff is proposing to you is to fully recover for the city the costs that are reasonably borne, as I understand it.
That's correct.
Thank you.
Any questions? Councilmember Burr.
Mr. Pressy, from these residents that, well, do we have people that come and complain at your office regarding this issue as far as, I guess I'm just concerned where, you know, sometimes there's misunderstandings and yeah, we have a cost with their police officers to go to this home, but do you have people coming over complaining at your department as far as the rates are too high or things like that? Where or what is it that we're doing? For example, there's a family that just decides not to pay.
Sure. That's a very good question, Councilman. And there has been a disconnect in the community as far as even knowing that there is a false alarm fee. And I think there's some of you have probably known someone who's got a false alarm bill, and the way the ordinance is currently written is that all the false alarm providers are supposed to notify those new customers that there is this fee and to go register with the police department and pay a permit, and then they're registered with the police department. And then there's an annual renewal of that. That's a cost of their owning alarm service and getting quality service when there's an alarm that goes off and the police responding quickly. As far as being too high, personally, still being new, I haven't heard a lot of that, but I think anytime you raise a rate 20%, that's significant. And we did discuss this at the Finance Committee, and we did. Jeff Weir, I was out of town, he took it to the Business Development Task Force, which is represented by SUBA, the Chamber, Old Town Association, and to inform them and to get feedback. I think one of the board members had a comment that the police never came in that instance, but in that instance I did research, and if there is a call out to that alarm and there's happens to be a life-threatening priority one call that's there interrupted or for whatever reason interrupted, both are important, but there are levels of priority. They will respond to the life-threatening situation that they know is life-threatening. For whatever reason they were diverted, in that case the process is where that person would not get billed, and that has been a concern that I've heard is, you know, if the police don't come, you know, I shouldn't be billed, and that is the process.